Good morning, New Hopians. How is everybody? Yeah, my name's Peggy. So glad that you're all here. As you can see, Pastor Tim isn't yet. Okay, he's going to try to be with us this evening, but right now he's resting. I want to thank everybody for all their prayers, and he said he could feel them and just wants to thank you for diligently praying for him. And I think for those of you that didn't get our email this week, if you want to get our All White Church emails, make sure and fill out the guest insert that's in the pews. That's a way that we can all stay connected. And if you're new this Sunday, welcome. We're so glad that you came to join us. Our pastor did have some stints put in today or last week, and so it's been a little bit crazy, a little eventful this week. And I think with all of you, he's been able to get through it, and we're very excited. I want to talk about a little bit of what's in the bulletin, but I'm not going to read it to you. We've got some sign-up sheets that we're passing around. We have a couple of new things that are going to happen at New Hope, and it's Bunko. How many have played Bunko, the dice game? See? Yes. This is going to be a fun thing we're going to do for fellowship coming up in September. It's for men, women, any ages. No experience is needed, and it's just a way we can have a fun evening. And we're going to have childcare because our youth group is going to be at the Jam Center and take care of the kiddos, so nobody has an excuse that they can't be able to make it. So we do have limited seating for it because we're thinking maybe 100 people we can put in the bridge and the pavilion. So if you'll sign up for how many people are coming and how many kiddos, that helps us make preparations for the evening as well. Everybody looks so serious. Yeah, let's smile. Let's smile. Yeah, things are good. Things are good. Tim did get some disturbing news from his doctor besides all the stents this week. He has to start eating vegetables. You think that's funny? He does not eat vegetables. Like, I don't think he eats any vegetables, which maybe is a little bit tells you, you know, what kind of happens when you don't eat vegetables. I was telling the 8 o'clock service when I started working, Tim says, I hate chocolate, and I don't eat vegetables. And for me, the chocolate was almost a deal breaker because I eat chocolate every single day. And I thought, who doesn't like chocolate? But so for everybody that has some great recipes on vegetables, we want to make sure to give Tim and Shelley so he can eat healthy because we want him here for a long, long time. Still got a lot of stuff to do. We also have our Angel Tree signups that's going around. I know New Hope, we're really such good supporters of the Angel Tree program from Present Fellowship. And they are able to provide Christmas gifts for kiddos whose families are incarcerated. It takes a team approach. We have a prayer team. We have a team that buys gifts, people that wrap the gifts, people that deliver the gifts, people that contact the families. So I think it's just a really nice way to do outreach. And there's something for everyone. So go ahead and sign up which one of the areas that you want it to get involved in. I want to also let you know that our Wednesday nights are going to get really busy around here for Jam for our children's ministry in September. September 9th, we're going to start the Wednesday night sessions from 7 to 8. And our adult Bible study that Pastor Nick teaches is going to start then as well. So it's kind of a family event. We've got surf going on for the 5th and 6th graders every Wednesday, and also the junior high. So Wednesday night is going to be really hopping around here, so please join us. At this time, I want to bring our ushers to accept our tithes and offerings, and I want us to pray. It's been a crazy week. Dear Lord, thank you for watching over all of us this week, Pastor Tim. We love you. We know that you've got something in mind for each and every one of us. Over the last several weeks, we've been talking about our plans, our purpose, our missions. Today, we're going to talk about back to Africa. And Mike Kuznow is going to lay on our hearts what his mission is. But each one of us have a plan, a purpose. I think it became too real with Pastor Tim this week. We never know what tomorrow brings. Let us be silent and hear your whispers. Let us hear what you have on your plate to give us. What are we supposed to be doing? We all were made for a specific purpose. What is that? What does that look like? I know sometimes we think we'll get around that when, but we never know. Let's start today. I also want to hold up in prayer Pastor Tim's cousin, who recently had her fourth baby last month. And last week she had a stroke. She's doing better, but she's still not able to speak. Wanda Wood's daughter. Shelly has found out that she has live cancer. They haven't identified where. We know Wanda Wood is a cancer survivor herself. Let's hold them up in prayer. Protect them. But God, I just hope that we use today to be able to hear your calling on our lives and not to ignore it, to be bold, to go forward, and to show our love for you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Big day, it's back to Africa Mission Day in a lot of different ways. I know when our team went out back in February to take off and when they got back, we wanted to do an evening follow-up to kind of tell their story. And it just happened when we were able to get the calendar together that Mike Kuzno was going to be in town. Who knew that Tim was going to be gone? So God has a plan, right? And so we're here to take it off. I think the neat thing is Tim's sleeping today because he's going to come tonight. So we'll be able to see him. Because 1040i and this Africa mission is near and dear to Tim's heart, and we all know that. He has been passionate about it. I remember at the 8 o'clock service a few years ago when Tim was preaching, and all of a sudden he said, "It's in my heart that I'm going to Africa," because he hadn't gone before. Others had gone, and he hadn't. And that morning, he said, "I feel like God laid it on my heart. I have to do it," and he's not looked back. So we're fortunate to have Mike Kuzno to talk to us this morning about his passion. Mike's been friends with Tim for over 40 years. How does that happen? We're not old enough to have relationships that long, right? Don't you feel young at heart? And our bodies kind of start, what did Tim say last week? Start decaying. But you don't feel that way. You don't feel that way. So they've had this friendship for over 40 years. Mike Kuzno has been working with 1040i and created it. He's been working in the Ivory Coast for over 45 years. On the prayer we talked about, put in our hearts, what's God got for us to do? Well, he knows what God has for him to do. I was going to do the introduction. He's gotten all these awards for humanitarian feats that he's done over there in the Ivory Coast. For a lot of places, it's a place that people have forgotten, and they think it's too desperate. But in his heart, he knows it's not. To describe Mike, I said, driven, passionate, focused, and a love for the Lord. I want us to come back tonight and hear from our peeps on how he changed their lives and that experience. But we're going to hear from Mike this morning on what's on his heart and how big our God is. So welcome, Mike Kuzno. But first, we're going to watch a DVD, and I want you to hear the narrator. It's going to be a very familiar sound when you hear it. And that'll give us a little bit of inkling of what's going to be going on tonight. But go ahead, roll the DVD.
Haven't put his teeth together.
How do you describe the indescribable? How do you explain the unexplainable? And how do you make believable the unbelievable? This is my task over the next several minutes.
I'm thinking as far as leading.
And I must tell you an astonishing story of 44 different people, from surgeons to IT specialists, nurses to carpenters, AC technicians to anesthesiologists, teenagers to retired professionals. They would overcome adversity and together make a difference in the lives of people who they've never met and most of the world doesn't even know exist. We would gather for breakfast, receive directions, and begin the arduous work of fulfilling the destinies we had volunteered for. Some unloaded medical supplies, organized and sterilized surgical rooms and equipment. Others loaded tools and materials to deliver at a dormitory construction site for seventh grade boys and girls. While others prepared crafts and refreshments and life-changing lessons for KidFest 2015 in a village called Neonen. This was a first of its kind, four-day kids extravaganza. They had never seen this in that part of the world. Over the next 8 days, the three primary goals of 1040i were pursued relentlessly: health, education, and water. In the area of health, 85 surgeries were performed by four surgeons, 19 orthopedic surgeries, 23 surgeries to improve the health of women, 14 maxillofacial, and 29 general surgeries. Some of these were life-saving surgeries, but all of them were life-improving procedures. One patient who arrived more dead than alive and in excruciating pain said after her surgery, "Thank you for coming. Thank you for taking such good care of me. Please don't stop. Please keep taking care of others. You see, the light of goodness shines bright in the darkest places." In the area of education, a two-room dormitory able to house 36 junior high boys and girls was completed. 18 bunk beds were built. Sheets, blankets, pillows were provided for each bed, and demonstrations to all the students on how to make a bed was provided. The only bed these students had known before was the floor. Desks and solar lighting were provided so the students would have a place and the means of doing homework at night. Education is the key to improve prosperity in this region of the world. 36 bicycles were provided so the students can make the 6-mile journey each way, each day. In the area of water, through a generous sponsor, each of the 36 students received a water purifying system to give to their parents. This system can purify 1 million gallons of water. Word got around of what 1040i was doing, and regional government officials showed up for the dedication of the dormitory in Neonen. They witnessed firsthand the love, and they heard, many for the first time, of the faithfulness of Mike Cousineau and 1040i. This love and this faithfulness has been going on for decades. The Ebola publicity frightened many away and threatened to shut down the project before it even launched. But several overcame fear with courage they didn't know they had. The travel is challenging. 6 days, 8,000 miles to work, 8 15-hour-plus days. The temperatures are smothering. Some days were 125 degrees and the humidity was 70% or higher. The dust is endless. The poverty is staggering. The environment extremely harsh. So why do we do it? Because the opportunities are endless, the needs are desperate, the appreciation of the Ivorians is astounding, the results are immediate and ongoing, and relationships are forged in the fervor of this work that are life-changing. Nearly everyone this narrator spoke with agreed this was the hardest 2 weeks in their entire life. But without exception, every one of them said, "I'll do it again." Their life made a difference to others. To give with no thought of reward, to share with no thought of recognition, to sacrifice for others and not self, is so foreign to 21st century American culture. We all were astonished at the end of this story. Lives will never be the same because of what we did, and my life will never be the same because I went. maybe next year, you will be part of an amazing and an astonishing story. Investigate the opportunities in 2016. Volunteer. Make a difference. Become a part of something that is indescribable, that is unexplainable, and that is unbelievable. I believe you'll be glad you did.
Good morning. It's an honor and always a privilege to be here with you, to be able to share what God has laid on my heart, what God is doing, and how God is using New Hope. As Peggy introduced and she said, you know, I've been there for a long time. And every time I see this newest video of our project in February, it just shoots emotions through my heart. And through my being, you know, Tim was narrating and he mentions about a lady who came to location, more dead and alive. And she said, thank you for caring. Thank you for helping me. Please continue to help others. Fortunately, she was a believer. And she was saying those words on her deathbed. We had tried everything. We had taken her into surgery. We had taken her back into surgery. And after the second time we rushed her back into surgery, that's when she said, thank you for caring. It takes uncommon people. Because what you saw on this screen is an uncommon event. It takes uncommon people to go to a harsh location and to love on a people who are so totally different than themselves and just love on them. And I remember this very day, because as events started to unfold, and as the overseer of the project, sometimes you have to make tough decisions and you have to make tough calls. And I remember one of our team members just sitting on the floor with this lady, and she was just singing her into her next journey. For me, it was one of the most precious scenes that I'd seen in a long time, but a difficult thing. But that's the type of people that go and do. And that is the word that I would like to develop this morning, and it is uncommon. People do often say things about me that are uncommon, that I'm an uncommon person. I'm a person without, between several worlds. And just this past week, somebody I was in a conversation, and a friend of mine, he said, "Mike, we don't do that in America." I said, "Oh, really? Okay." So I wanted to see exactly what the American culture calls and how they define uncommon. So all of you are familiar with Mr. Webster. When you were in school, you probably had one of his books, a Webster dictionary. So I looked up in the dictionary exactly how our culture defines uncommon. And this is what he says. He says, defined as rare, not common, or usual, strange, remarkable, extraordinary. The 44 people that went last year, and amongst them there were several from New Hope, I would call them extraordinary people. I would call them remarkable. And in fact, I have come to the point in my life, to this position, that New Hope Community Church is absolutely a remarkable and an extraordinary fellowship. You are uncommon. And I can speak with authority on this because I travel across the country and I am in contact with a lot of fellowships. God brought your pastor and myself together as just young lads some 40 years ago, and we went our ways. I went to Africa, and he came to another foreign country. Not really. He came to California, and then later in life, God would, through his providence, he would bring us back together, and we would knit together a friendship that I believe is inseparable, and then began sharing our hearts. And I would come and he would stay, and I would come here and share and he would stay. And then finally, I popped the question, "Tim, how about coming yourself and ministering with me in my location?" And it was, you know, something, of course, that he had to take to prayer. And isn't it wonderful how God works in the uncommon ways? He was praying, and then God just told me, "I'm going to Africa." And it has been an absolute blessing, and it's been an encouragement as he has led many of you. And he has led your congregation to focus in an area of the world that God has spotlighted for us to do. One of the things that distinguishes the 1040 Initiative and us, is that where we are working and what we are doing, no one else is. So I am convinced that it is our divine responsibility, and we're taking it very serious. As Peggy said, I'm a driven person, and I'm focused on solutions, and we usually find them with God's grace. We improvise, we work hard, and the people work hard. You know, I think in this day and time, we would call that uncommon. Uncommon people are defined this way. They never believe that God wants to send us to safe places to do easy things. Because where we go, there are some risks, and it's hard. It's not easy. But the task that is there and the reward that comes from doing the task, you heard Tim say, people have said it's the hardest 2 weeks of my life. But it was refreshing. And without hesitation, most of them said they would go back. Now, there was one lady from California. I'll not disclose the location. I travel throughout California. After the 18-hour journey, she made the comment, "I'll never come back. This is way too hard." Well, she hadn't even started the project yet, and she was bailing out. But God has a sense of humor. I know that. And I think God just said, "Really? Just let me see what I can do about that. If you dispose your heart, if you allow me to work in your heart," and that's my prayer for you this morning, that you would allow God to work in your heart. And if we allow God to work in your heart, he'll do something. And so God went to work on her heart. And you know, well, there's an expression that we say, time has a way of healing. We just need time. So in April of this year, we would begin the process of putting together a team to do a women's medical initiative project the 1st of July. And so my secretary sent out a word to all of our medical people saying, "Who's in?" And guess what? This very lady that morning had been praying and asking God, "What would you like me to do? What can I do? I'm retired. I'm bored." And she had some really great skills that we needed. And her computer says, "You have mail." And she opened the mail, and there was the request. She was the first person to respond positively, and I think that very day wrote a check and sent it in for her airline ticket. It's kind of uncommon. And God takes the common, and if we allow him, he will make it uncommon. So uncommon people never believe that God wants to send us to safe places to do easy things. Uncommon people do not hold to the fact that faithfulness is holding the fort, is just staying here in our comfort zone. Now, uncommon people don't believe that that's exactly what it means. Uncommon people do not believe that playing it safe is safe. And uncommon people believe that there isn't any greater privilege than sacrifice. The trip, and it's okay to say it, the trip was a sacrifice. And people sacrificed. It's not easy, but again, rewarding. Why can I call your church, your fellowship, an uncommon fellowship? Here's the reason. Because when you were exposed to a need last year, you responded. You responded not only in a positive way, but in an extraordinary way. We have discovered exactly, we have pinpointed exactly where God is working. And God is at work and has been working for years, even before we discovered it, in this village of Nyona, where God sent a couple of ladies, African ladies, as missionaries to this area while the Civil War was going on, and they discovered in this particular village of Nyona a vacant school. And you remember, I told the story last year, it stayed vacant for 22 years. It had been built and never opened. And God put on the hearts of these ladies to go to courtyard for several miles around and talk to the parents and ask them to send their children to school. And they did. except for the girls. Because the girls do a lot of work. Actually, women do a lot of work in Africa, and sometimes people wonder, do the men even work? Well, they do. They do some. And so they went back, and they asked the mothers, please send your daughters to school. And they sent their daughters. So they worked with these children for 6 years, and after 6 years, these children would go to another town about 5 miles away to middle school. Now, going to that town, most of the people that go on the trip would call this town Doropo in the bush. But I would call it a metropolitan city for that area because they have a gas station. They have a bakery to bake bread. They have the essential food items. So these kids were coming out of this deep bush and 5 miles away to this metropolitan city and being exposed to things they'd never been exposed to before. And it really gripped their hearts. They said, we need to do something to put a safety net over these children. And you responded. And we built a dormitory. And in February, we put the roof on it. And we built the bunk beds. And we put solar lighting in. And we built a facility for them to take outdoor showers in a bucket, or not a shower, but a bucket bath. If you want to understand what that is, talk to me later. You probably are going to be forced to be going into that in California before too long. So come and talk to me, and I'll ease you in. I remember one of our real dainty team members several years ago when my wife was on the project as well and said, well, we're going to take a bucket bath tonight. And this was a nurse. You know, like I said, she was dainty, and she just started crying. She said, I've never taken a bucket bath. What is that? You know. But we provided that, and we provided a bathroom facility for them. They never had this before. They felt loved. They were given love like they'd never had before. They'd never slept in a bed. We provided a bed. Never had a sheets. Never had mattress. Uncommon. That was uncommon for them. And it was an uncommon congregation that provided this. Why? Because of love. And these young people have felt loved. And this fits in part of the strategy that I believe that God has started us on. And the vision that I have is to reshape this nation for God. It's a God-sized vision. And that's the best type of vision to have. Because if it was a smaller vision, you know, we might start gloating and thinking, well, look what I did. But to accomplish a God-sized vision, it's God's intervention. And we start, and we're starting, and we're pouring ourselves into these young people. And this school is the number one school today in that particular region. And it has happened because of godly women and some men who love these kids, pouring into them and teaching them God's word. I was there the 1st of July, and I went and talked to the main lady. Her name is Elise. July is vacation time, and she and her colleague have adopted 13 of these children. And she said, we're taking all 13 of them to the capital city because we don't want to leave them by themselves in town. We don't know how we're going to do it. We're going to have to rent a small bus, but we're going to do it. I said, that's noble. She didn't ask me for anything, and I didn't give her anything. I wanted to step back and watch. And about 10 days later, I met her in the capital city, Abidjan. She came with one of her sons, about 14 years of age. Unbeknown to his mother named him with a very significant name, and I think a stamp put on his life that God is going to use this young man, and his name means God has given. Dieudonné. He ranked number 2 in the entire nation scholastically. He's going somewhere. So she brought him, and we met at the house, and I said, Elise, I said, our partners with Nyona that built the dorm, they provided the bikes, all of these things. I said, they have something special for you. And I had not breathed a word of what was in the making. And I said, they are sponsoring all of your middle school kids that are in this dorm for this next school year. And she dropped her head. And she said, oh, Jesus. And it was a working of faith again. It was a faith builder because they had been praying. And she had gathered these kids together and they've been praying. They did not know how they would start the new school year. And I put part of the funds in her hands. And she goes downstairs because she left Dieudonné. And she said, Dieudonné, look, God has answered our prayer. And it was a faith builder for Dieudonné as well. Uncommon. That was an uncommon event. And God used an uncommon church. And in this church, God used uncommon people. For those of you that stepped up and said, I want to sponsor one of them. I read in a magazine yesterday that the United States will spend $68 billion in purchasing school supplies to send their children to school this year. $68 billion. An astonishing amount. Sometimes we say little as much if God is in it. And those of you that contributed to help in the school needs of these children, God is using it in incredible ways, and I just hope and pray, my prayer is that you will be blessed and that you are encouraged. God has given you this village, Nyona. And it is through these kids and another ministry that we're doing in the area of education, God is going to raise up leaders. And we're watching them. I'm watching the ones that are rising to the surface, and we're going to, in fact, I told Elise, I said, I'm taking Dieudonné away from you, and I'm going to place him in a school in Abidjan, and she begged me, she said, please don't take him now, but we're going to watch him, and we're going to watch the other ones, and we're going to pour into them, and we're going to help them rise up as godly leaders. And the reason I know it can happen is because of my recent experience as well. And let me share this with you briefly. I'll try to be briefly. You will be out of here by 10:30 because I have been given strict instructions. In July, we partnered with the Minister of Finance and Economy. It's like the Secretary of Treasury from our country. So they call them ministers. And she comes from a village in this area. She comes out of total poverty. I have passed through her village hundreds of times. She, as a little girl, was given an opportunity to go to school. And she excelled in school. And today she is one of the top government leaders in the country. She holds most of the purse strings because she was given an opportunity. And we're giving an opportunity, a much better opportunity than she had, because we're loving on these kids and we're sharing Christ with them. And they're doing Bible studies. They're getting these kids up at 5 o'clock in the morning and they're spending time in the Word and praying and singing. An incredible investment. Uncommon. Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. He died to absolutely make us dangerous. And to the enemy, we are dangerous. The council of the village where Nona is sent a representative to Elise and said, they want to know where you want to be buried when you die. They didn't like what she was doing. And she boldly said, you go back and you tell those people that sent you that I did not come here to die. And when God is finished with me in Nona, he will send me somewhere else. We're dangerous. We're dangerous people. And my challenge to you is to live your life dangerously. Don't cow down. Don't be timid. You know, in a safe environment, and today this is a safe environment, and we can sing boldly. And, you know, we're soldiers, and let's be the same when we walk out these doors and into our communities and stand for what we believe and stand and be dangerous. Joshua, as he was preparing his people for greater and incredible things, he said to them, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. And that also is my challenge for you this morning. Consecrate yourselves, because God wants to do amazing, incredible, uncommon things through your life. We understand that consecrate means to set ourselves apart. And so I have a question to you. What if Jesus really meant what he said? What if he really meant it? What kind of question is that, Mike? Of course we believe Jesus meant what he said. And I think his disciples got that too. You know, he had spent several years with his disciples, teaching them, and then he was beaten, he was crucified, he died, and he rose again, and he spent some more time with his disciples. And the very last words of exhortation that Jesus gave to his disciples, that the Bible records, the very last thing, he said, take the truth that I have shared with you and take it to all peoples of the world. All peoples. Get out of Jerusalem, because there are people out there to the uttermost parts of the world. Take it. He's coming back. Do you think he might ask, do you remember the last words I spoke to my people? How will we respond? I want to conclude with just a story, an extraordinary story of a young lady. You know, one time I said, I love women. I have three women in my life, by the way, and they're the ones that I love. But I love the courage of women. I love the leadership of women. Sometimes, guys, we need to stand up and step up to the plate. But there's a story of a woman in the scripture, and the men rebuked her. And Jesus said, leave her alone, because what she has done is a great thing. And this story is found in all of the Gospels, and her name is revealed in the fourth Gospel of John, in the Gospel of John, and her name is Mary. And she had not been a good woman through her life, but she had come to that point. And so she came and she anointed Jesus. You remember the story. She had an alabaster full of perfume, and it was worth an entire year's of wages. And she broke it and she anointed Jesus. And the disciples said, why this waste? What a waste. And Jesus rebuked them. Just think about it. Most of you on April the 15th filed your tax returns. And there's one line item on the bottom. I think it's on the first page. You look at it, and it's your total income for the year. Can you imagine taking that figure and giving it all to Jesus? Well, you know, some of these disciples, they're kind of like us. They said, why did she waste this? We could have taken this and sold it and then used the money to help the poor. That's not what they were just talking. She was uncommon. She was an uncommon person. I've been a big advocate of playing offense. I believe that we need to knock on the door of opportunities. And sometimes we need to knock the door down. We don't always need for opportunities to come to us. We need to go get them. We shouldn't wait to let it happen. We need to make it happen. But I will warn you. Let me warn you. Most of the time it comes with great sacrifice. Uncommon. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Tim, for being uncommon. Thank you for leading your church to be uncommon, to reach a new generation, and help to raise them up to change the direction of this country. Thank you this morning for giving me this opportunity to share with you. May God richly bless you for his glory and his honor. Thank you.
I feel like my heart's been turned around and pulled out and put back in, and wow, that was awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much. You don't want to miss tonight, because there's more of it to see what's next and to hear how lives were transformed by our own congregation for the folks that went and were on this journey with Mike. And the most important thing, who volunteered in this service to bring homemade ice cream? Okay, don't forget. Don't forget. Tim's not supposed to eat any, but I don't know. He might try to do a little bit tonight. I don't know, but he'll be there. Yeah. A lot of praying went on this week. It's important. It's important to spend time with God. And I want to remind everybody, Fawn and her team's going to be out there selling those tickets to The War Room, which is a movie about prayer. Let's stand up and be bold and show the theaters that we want Christian movies. We want those messages out there. We're proud. Okay, $5. What a great way to invite somebody in your neighborhood that doesn't have that feeling yet, doesn't know about the Lord. Okay? It'll change their lives. Thank you for coming today. Have an awesome afternoon, and hopefully we'll see you back at 6 o'clock tonight. Thanks.